Okay, good evening. Call to order the work session for October 28th, 2014. We're going to change the order on a few agenda items. Tonight, we're actually going to switch number one and number two. Biosolids facility visit we'll have as two, but we'll go ahead and start with presentation and discussion regarding the proposed Pilgrimage Music Festival at Harlansdale Park. And I know we have a large contingency of people, and so come up and sit down at our table and
we have Monique, who chairs our special events team, and Lisa Clayton, obviously our parks director. This is an event proposed for Harlansdale Farm for next fall, next September, and we'll let this team walk you through the event. What we wanted to do tonight is just present an overview. We are in the process of finalizing the application. The last piece, a traffic study, was received today, and we're reviewing that now. We anticipate bringing this to you at the next meeting for consideration, and possibly for consideration at both meetings. They have a pretty developed concept they want to bring to you tonight and walk it through with you and entertain your questions so that we can make sure we're answering them appropriately through the application process as well. So, Monique or Lisa, anything else to add?
No, we just appreciate you being here. It's something very different that we've ever had within our community, and excited about the possibilities to bring that to our citizens. So I'll let them kind of introduce themselves and
if I could just interrupt, please. 1 second, I actually skipped number two on the agenda, which was citizen comments, and I apologize to the citizen that they wanted to speak, and we'll let them speak after this. Does anybody want to speak tonight?
Item's not on the agenda.
Item's not on the agenda? Well, good. I just need to get that out so I didn't get in trouble. So anyway, excuse me. Go ahead now.
We always put our citizens first.
Citizens first. Thank you so much for allowing us on your agenda. I know your time is precious, so we'll hit our bullet points and explain the Pilgrimage Music and Cultural Festival. My name is Kevin Griffin. This is Brant Wood, Caitlin Salisbury, and we're honored to be here this evening. About 4 years ago, January will be 4 years that I've moved my family, my three boys and my wife, from L.A. After a five-year post-Katrina stint in L.A., we moved to Franklin, Tennessee, and I was drawn to Franklin because of its quality of life. It's the southern small-town charm. I grew up in Monroe, Louisiana, in New Orleans, and I kind of longed for a return to the basics of what I knew growing up. This past December, I was jogging, and I found myself in Harlansdale Farm, in the park in Harlansdale, and after a 20-plus year in a career in the music industry and playing a lot of festivals, I saw the perfect setting for a music festival with the rolling hills and the natural amphitheater, so I'm sure things you guys are all very aware of. The music festival market is pretty full of different festivals, so immediately I was like, how would we make a festival that would be unique, and how would we make a festival that would be specific and suit Franklin? And I called Brant Wood, who's a lifelong friend from New Orleans, and another partner of mine, Michael Whalen. And I was like, what we should do is a festival that's built around what we grew up with, which is the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival. It's a day festival that goes from 11 to 7 p.m. every day for 2 days, Saturday and Sunday. It's family friendly. It skews as an older demographic, a music festival, and something that is more bucolic and Franklin-centric. There is a charitable component, the Pilgrimage Foundation, which we can get into further, but something that could grow with the community. We could take baby steps and do this together every year. We're going to be coming back and getting your approval and seeing how we did. But we have some bullet points to go over, and I will turn that over to Brant Wood.
Thanks, Kevin. My name is Brant Wood. Known Kevin for a lifetime. Grew up in New Orleans, and like Mr. Stuckey was saying, we're here to give an overview. We've got materials for you after this presentation that will go into more detail about some of the technical things that we've been going over with staff, and we've had a great experience working with your city and since June, making various presentations and getting into the details and finding out that We have some shared values with regards to a quality festival, keeping it right-sized for this community and for the venue. As Kevin was saying, we hope to really score some great kind of high quality. It's not really about quantity at first. In a festival business, you want to book great bands. You want to show the guests that are lucky enough, we hope they believe, to get a ticket to see what we're calling a curated boutique festival, a festival that is really an event size so that we can have a good impact in the music industry and create a coveted ticket for people that are local and regional. We are going to showcase the music roots of Franklin and Nashville area. We're also going to draw on New Orleans and Memphis and the Mississippi Delta and call it a roots-based lineup. Bands contemporary and mature that are inspired by the genres of music that this region and the Gold Record Road is known for. So we're just really excited about our receptivity and the meetings that we've had with you guys, and we have endeavored to address the various things, and we're here to talk about them tonight in our overview, but we also have them in front of you with more detail with regards to attendance and traffic and such things like that. The economic sort of footprint is gonna stay local. We have a real desire to hire and employ the vendors and the merchants and the staff from the local community, and the festival ends at an early hour so that we can send people back into town to patronize restaurants and to stay at the hotels and to go to the venues for shows that would be later in the evening. So the Jazz Fest works like that. It's a great economic model, and the city benefits quite a bit from that model.
It's basically, we want Harlansdale to be, and Franklin to be, the headline act. It's such a beautiful historic venue. We want to showcase the city, and by having a day festival that showcases the music, the artisans, and the food of Franklin and Middle Tennessee, I think we'll be able to do that. By ending at 7 o'clock, we'll be able to activate the people who come to the festival to go into the city, to Franklin Theater, the Factory, to Kimbrough's, to Red Pony, 55 South, to patronize the different restaurants and venues.
So, you know, we have our kind of a bio on us in the handout that goes into some detail about our experience with festivals and music and Kevin as an artist and a variety of different events, and I've been in the venue and restaurant business, so it's sort of a hospitality entertainment skill that I bring to the table. We've also partnered with another New Orleans company called Hookah Entertainment, very experienced festival promoter, and a lot of their materials are available in our handout and online as well. So, as Kevin was saying, and he was right, when I came to see Harlansdale, I was moved at how ideal the venue is. It's really a special place. We plan on making a weekend that lasts all year in terms of resources that we want to give back and improvements that we want to do and just things that would benefit the park year round. And of course, Franklin, it reminds me, I went to Washington and Lee, and Lexington, Virginia is a small version with so much history and architecture that you clearly take a lot of pride in. So it's as he was just saying, Harlansdale and Franklin are really the headliners of the event, and I think that's important to you guys as we've heard.
Absolutely.
So
we can go to the next. The music, we want it to be roots based. Bands like Tom Petty, Jack Johnson, Brad Paisley is going to be a multi-genre music festival. Stressing acoustic performances. That hasn't been done in the festival grouping thus far. A lot of bands that we've approached have been very excited about the prospect of playing acoustic, and I think that will suit the history and setting of Harlansdale Farm and make our festival unique and even more family-friendly. We will also showcase the Gold Record Road and the Americana Music Triangle. If you know Aubrey Preston, he is a big fan of that, and I think it's a great way to anchor the Music Triangle.
So the, you know, the again, the first year, we want to run before we walk. We want to walk before we run, excuse me. And pick a ticket count that works for the traffic capacity, parking capacity, traffic flow, the venue, of course, and it allows us to establish a budget that will secure a lineup that we think will be a good start to the festival, somewhere we can grow from. We looked at a lot of numbers. If you've seen some of our early materials, we were talking about some larger amounts of ticket sales, but the pendulum kept coming back to 15,000 tickets per day as a number that gave us the threshold where we could cross into a place where there's marquee entertainment, there's a lot of good middle-sized acts, there's the kind of infrastructure and production that befits a lot of the music and the kind of quality that we think pilgrimage and the community and the venue would deserve. And with a parking study that you have in the handout by a local engineer, we have identified enough parking and enough ingress and egress to support that number. So we hope that as you guys review the application, you guys can sort of appreciate that was a number we derived from some careful study.
The traffic study will show that with just parking spots on property and surrounding schools and stuff that have been contacted, parking alone and cars will support 15,000 people. That's not allowing for anybody walking up or riding bicycles or taking the transit system. What we've seen in the past, most major festivals, and you'll see this in the handout, have zero parking. So we're really fortunate with Harlansdale Farm that we do have the parking to cover the amount of people we'd like to have. One thing we'd love to see is you know, a lot of people biking into the festival, and a lot of times a festival can dictate a move to greenways and that kind of thing. What we would love to see in the future is the charitable arm of Pilgrimage Foundation, of Pilgrimage Productions, is a Pilgrimage Foundation. It'll be a board, a sitting board of the partners and local Franklin people who can dictate where funds from Pilgrimage are used or allocated, whether it's Friends of Franklin Park or the Historic Foundation, and basically only improve the park at Harlansdale, but also Bicentennial Park. I live here. You know, my goal is to take a place that drew me and my wife 4 years ago and only try to make it better. And one of the things I would love to do, being an avid biker and jogger, is to be able to help with the connectivity of Franklin so we can bike and jog all the way around the city from Mac Hatcher and not have to get on Old Hillsborough Road. One of those things would be, and it's in the 20-year plan for Harlansdale, is to make those walking bridges on the south side of Harlansdale Farm a reality, and that's something that we would love to do. You'll hear us mention the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival ad nauseum, only because we grew up with it, and it's a festival in New Orleans that's been around for 40-plus years. There is the for-profit aspect of it, but the only reason Jazz Festival has worked is because of the nonprofit aspect of it. It's become a part of the fabric of the city. And you can go as a child to Jazz Fest, and as an adult, there's something for everybody. The same with Pilgrimage. And what's going to be unique about Pilgrimage is that it's going to be Franklin's festival. It's going to highlight the music, the culture of Franklin and Middle Tennessee.
And I think that it's important to note that the venues of the festivals that inspire us, including New Orleans Jazz Fest, but there's others, the venues are almost always a public park, and they are beneficiaries of various improvements and exposure, and the connectivity to other ingress and egress points that have made it a great park day to day, not just during the festival. And so that's our sort of inspiration to share with you guys that the park in Franklin would be something that would maintain a sort of, we call it headline status, but really a focus of a year-round opportunity to look at the things that were big wins and best practices and what could we have done better, and find ways to ease areas of access and make it, you know, and do some things that are beneficial year-round. So that sort of inspires us about such a gem as Harlansdale. You know, we've met with y'all's staff and some authorities, and the idea of making sure that we've got adequate on-site presence of police and fire and rescue and EMTs is something that every producer is required to focus on and to make a priority. And so there's certainly that that focus of ours. And so from listening closely, and we just listen in these meetings and take notes, adding in turn lanes, having on-site stations with radio communication to talk about weather and to talk about if there's any incidences, that's the only way a festival can march forward, is to ensure the community and the ticket holders that that's a priority of ours. And in this case, it is. We'll be hiring y'all's finest. We have a lot of history in the festival and the venue business, and that means being very judicious and adherent to the local and state laws when it comes to alcohol consumption. In our case, that means hiring trained servers of legal age. One of the nuances that we want to bring to the table is we would allow charity groups, Rotary Club, to come in and serve if they wish. Those tips roll in pretty heavily. They're welcome to take those and apply them to their cause. That's a model that works at the Jazz Festival. And you see all kind of clubs and organizations out there having a blast making money for their organization. And so that's something we're happy to open up. The idea that we want to come back means we'll be carding people, being very strict, and making sure that they're having a good experience if they choose to consume alcohol.
Brent makes a really good point. The whole drive for us is to activate the populace and activate the people in Franklin. Whether you're helping your dad run food from the restaurant down to Harlandsdale the day of the festival, or you're working at one of the beer gardens or one of the restaurants, it's to activate everybody in the community. So in 2-3 years, it really is part of life in Franklin. And we're kind of, you'll notice that we're doing parking and alcohol safety and emergency preparation. But the bottom line, it's a blast. It's just a great time. It's a fun time to look to year after year. But again, we want to take baby steps and learn from you what type of festival looks good to you. We have a lot of experience doing festivals, but we don't have all the answers for a festival that looks right to you in Franklin, so it's a give and take.
Can you tell he's a musician? He addresses the microphone a lot better than I do.
I could go wireless and we could go crazy.
Moreover on what Kevin is saying, that it's fun, and it's there's something so charming about Harlandsdale, the patina of the old buildings and barns and sharecropper shacks, and what y'all have done to the main stable is really unlike, there's not a festival in the country that can boast such a picturesque, idyllic setting. And for the type of music we want to offer, I've been promising some of the bands that I'm wooing and romancing right now that these stages are going to be set with backdrops like they've never seen. And actual barns will have fans blowing from the ceilings of the stages, and really kind of create an authentic look to the stages that will make for they'll almost look like the barns of Harlandsdale when I'm finished with them. I mean, we have some ideas about how to clad them with reclaimed wood and really make for an experience that would be unmatched. And so we're obviously excited to move into those phases of planning this festival when we can satisfy you guys on the application side.
I touched a little bit on Pilgrimage Foundation, but to get into it more, we would work with Friends of Franklin Park, Historic Foundation, different schools for after-school programs. The first thing that comes to mind are music programs. That's something we see that works really well with the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival Foundation. And we will always be willing to see what else would seem worthy and that you guys think would be a good beneficiary of Pilgrimage Foundation.
Should we talk about the kitchen stage?
We should talk about the kitchen.
So there's some things that we want to create some new ideas and some things that'll get the attention of what is sometimes called a crowded festival market. There's festivals around that are very different than ours. There's some that are small curated boutique festivals that even if they're hundreds and hundreds of miles away, we still consider them competition. We want to stand out. We have, because there's the music industry is so well represented in this region, we plan on having the stage sound curated by studios, having engineers come out and actually dial in and tune the PA and the stage sound just so that the artists and the guests can have an experience, sonic experience like none other. I mean, it'll be like a reference, like Kevin's studio. I mean, it'll sound that good. We also plan on having a curated food culinary experience where you will be able to taste some of the great kind of classic dishes. We have plenty back home. We have plenty, as I discovered here. And there'll be an actual stage that we're calling the kitchen stage where the band lineups for stages have, you know, this band at 2, this band at 3:30, and that's how people walk around with their lineup and look and see who's playing. But if they stop at the kitchen stage, they'll see that there's hot chicken at 2 o'clock and meat and 3 at 3:30, and those will be dishes will be on stage. And we'll have banquet tables set up with all kind of, you know, kind of authentic family-style service. So anyway, those are some of the things that we want to do to make it distinct, but also to show the sort of convivial, fun nature of the food and drink and music of this community. So we're excited about that.
There's also an area we call the Little Pilgrims area for kids. There'll be a children's stage with a full lineup of musical acts, as well as face painting and that sort of thing. Most of the festivals out there do that, and we will definitely be having a
Little Pilgrims. This is, as you guys discuss the logistics and see the safety plan and the things that we've submitted, it's important to, while this is a sort of roots-based festival, we're going to harness technology in the latest and most advanced way we can. That involves the way we sell tickets, the way we market online. We'll do traditional advertising, but one thing that is not something it's very recent is the way we communicate with the ticket holders. We have the ability with their email addresses and phone numbers to text them and to email them updates, do's and don'ts, where the parking is available, where it's not available. Our plan is to identify lots, and we have plenty of them in our traffic plan, but with 11 months to go, our sleeves have been rolled up a while, they're gonna stay rolled up. And we're gonna be out there identifying and securing with agreements whether we rent or do whatever beneficial arrangement, we will have, if we have 200 parking spots on Saturday at the factory, those 200 spots will be available to a ticket holder. When they're gone, those spots will close, and only those cars will be allowed to park in that spot. So it'll be our way of controlling the traffic flow to where we can spread it out, not have everybody coming to the two gates at Hollinsdale. The VIPs will have access to the spots in Hollinsdale, that's depicted here. Those folks will be the only ones instructed to come to the gate, and then with traffic officers and our staff checking credentials, they'll be allowed in. That's our way to try to mitigate the potential snarl of a two-lane road, which I think is an important thing to mitigate and to plan around. So we're going to do our best to use technology and to be smart about where we're parking people so that we don't, I mean, the ebb and flow of your regular weekend traffic needs to take place, plus we have a big event. You guys have great events. You have some quite large events that we've studied, and I think people love coming here. They probably love coming here for the good time and the event, but also because they tend to get in and out of town without a whole lot of snarl. So that's our goal as well.
Were you here on Saturday?
I wasn't.
For the pumpkin?
But we know 65,000? Was it?
I quizzed her. I was down at the LSU Ole Miss game. Sorry if you were an Ole Miss fan.
I sent you an LSU.
But I quizzed her, and she went down with the boys, and they had a great time. But apparently the traffic was manageable. I mean,
no.
It was heavy. Well, what we found, and you'll see in detail in the traffic study, is that our target number of 15,000 people we're well within our parameters of what Jillian says would work comfortably on Franklin Road. Also, since it's a day festival over about 10 hours, people are going to be coming in and out throughout the day, so it's not like a huge ingress at one time. So that will also ease any kind of burden.
And it's important to note that that's not 15,000 people between the factory and Harlinsdale. A lot of those folks will be going to the green lot or the blue lot, which will be sent to them on a grid that they know that they're parking at this church, which we've secured their Saturday lot, or this particular...
Or BGA.
Yeah, and
The Falcons Day, was that done in-house?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
No, they have prepared a traffic study that they've submitted to us today.
By Jillian Fishbach.
Jillian Fishbach did it. We're still reviewing it, so that's something staff had requested, and so it's still under review. And that's the last piece of the puzzle in terms of working through all the elements, and then the application will move forward. We expect at your next meeting.
Okay.
What kind of traffic was it that you were planning on? About how many cars?
Well, so 2.5 people per car is the kind of average head count in a car. So it's a 6,000 or so car count without anybody walking or biking up.
So we
will heavily promote biking, which we'll have racks for and give them some incentive to bike, but pedestrians, in our experience, a lot of the festivals have no parking. They don't go to the lengths of finding parking on or off site because they expect people to take a pedicab, walk, you know, bicycle, get a taxi. You know, there's just lots of other options. So, but we wanted to be ahead of that and to, you know, just be aware that the time and effort and resources that we're putting into this is an investment for a long-term relationship. And so, you know, with the article the next day has to be, the bands were amazing, everything was great, not, but you couldn't get out of there.
It's incumbent upon us to do our best to make sure everything is covered, because every year we got to come back to you guys. And if we don't do it right, there won't be a year two. So that said, we're going to be coming to you guys. Are you happy with the way this looks? No. Let's fix it. You know, the great thing is we have time in hand and a reasonable cap of 15,000 for this first year that allows us to make, you know, our, to get the bands we need.
Yeah, to get across that minimum threshold that we feel like we can have an impactful festival and still do that proverbial walk before we run.
Right. Baby steps, I would say.
Baby steps.
So 15,000 per day, 2 days.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. And the venue has two kind of larger stages and one medium-sized stage and then the kids' stage. So we're trying to keep it at a, you know, where we can invest in the quality, not the quantity of this first year. And probably going to stay in that philosophy of a boutique festival. There's festivals that have gone, you know, to numbers that would frighten you, but that's not our plan.
That's not us.
That's what I'm afraid of.
Yeah, let's let the Alderman ask some questions.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Alderman Berger, then Alderman Martin.
I was curious on the parking, so we'll get to that parking study later then. Or traffic study. The stages, now, these stages are going to be put up and then taken down?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Because a while back we had talked about an amphitheater there at one time, which I think we're still missing the mark big time on that amphitheater. That is a perfect place to have an amphitheater. Somebody came to us, we talked about it, it all went away, and we really never pursued it, which to our detriment, I think that is to our detriment. I think we need to have a really nice amphitheater. If you go over to Franklin Park right now, a corner of McEwen and Crothers, you'll see behind the new office building an amphitheater. Right. It's beautiful and it's small. You know, you can fit about 600 people there, maybe 500, I don't know, something like that. And it's a beautiful amphitheater outside, stair steps down into a lake in the little pond in the back, and then a big green field in the back of that. So anyway, I want to just talk about that some other time. I think we need to pursue that. So then, how are you, you know, I'm sure then you talked about sending people out to the restaurants and to the, you know, local businesses. So I would hope in your plans that you would put this in your plan to disseminate the information to people so they'll know where to go. So you can go to these restaurants, you go to these places, so that when people leave, they're going to like, okay, where are we going to go? And what's downtown? We don't know.
Right.
And you have a list of places where they're located, maybe with a phone number on it, and their hours of operation. And if you're going to do something like this, make sure you coordinate it with all these businesses, because I want to see that in your plans, because coordinating that with the businesses, I remember when our theater first opened, and I don't know how we're doing, because I've not really checked on it. The theater first opened, had a big to-do with Studio 10 there, and when everybody let out, every single person was hungry, especially the people who put it on, and the show people and everything, nowhere to go. Right. Everybody was closed. And I think Red Pony was open that night, so they were able to get over there and have something to drink, but they couldn't eat because the kitchen had just closed. And they said, gosh, we knew that. We would have held the kitchen open. So just in your plans, would you make sure you look into
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely.
Because that's only going to help our businesses if
Absolutely.
You plan on that. The other thing is,
if I were them, I'd sell that advertising, but that's just me.
I would too.
well, one thing.
I would too.
Well, that's none of my
business.
I would
too.
Our food midway, which we call the bazaar, will feature all the different restaurants selling their signature dishes at the midway. So there will be that communication, but also on the site, but duly noted. Thank you.
All right. The other thing is, so I hear you want to do this annually, right? Annually? Every year? Right. And then securing the bikes. If you're going to ask people to bike there, you better have a place to secure them and a way for the people to secure them.
Absolutely.
All right. Because that's a lot of festivals I've been to that up in Waynesburg and some other places, they've had a number of things when they always have the bike racks and they have the locks and things.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you.
Alderman Martin, then Alderman Bransford.
I just have a few things to get out of the way.
Yes, ma'am.
Is this another Bonnaroo?
Absolutely not.
Oh, shucks.
It is the opposite of Bonnaroo. The B word is a bad word to us. You know, I came to Franklin because I love the small town charm. I love that it's safe. It's a great place to live and raise my kids. And this is a festival that will be a Franklin festival, which skews older. It's older demographic. We're not going for kids. There is never any camping. You know, it is it's a food festival that will suit the rural high-end atmosphere of Franklin.
That's good if it can remain that way.
That is.
All right. Will the city be paid for the use of the park?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you would like to endear yourselves to the huge church-going community that we have here, you will open at noon on Sunday instead of 10 o'clock.
I think that certainly sounds constructive and something that we should. Our goal was to try to put some gospel on stage and really kind of open it with that kind of, that's what the Jazz Fest starts with, a gospel kind of rousing, and it really works. People come out. I mean, it has gospel tent that plays all day. I think here for our first year, we're going to open with some gospel, and I mean a good rocking experience. There's some groups out there that really can rock, but the last thing we want to do is get into a traffic situation as all the churches let out. So I think we're open-minded.
Or compete with church.
Certainly open-minded. The idea at 10 was to get them in there to stretch out the arrival time.
Yeah.
And
well, I don't know how you want to work that,
yes,
but
ma'am.
I know that it's just been sort of a policy when we have festivals that they, on Sunday, they wait for the churches to close.
I think that's something that,
that's a great idea.
Yeah.
Or you can have
they wouldn't be able
there.
To serve that till afternoon just because of ABC law, so
that's right.
Just on another note.
And that's a Sunday thing more than a Saturday thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or you could have church there.
Starting with gospel at 10, if we found, after speaking with you and speaking with some of the different churches, that they were like, we would love to do that, that would be something fun for the parishioners to do, then that sounds like a great time. Just
have service,
beautiful
have
day.
Service at the venue and have the pastor.
Have multiple churches get
yeah.
together.
Yeah. So you guys have a church's contribution, though, if you've got to pay $75 to get in. So,
I just
know that it's
a
policy.
Session.
Yes, ma'am.
That on Sunday,
yes, ma'am.
Out of respect for the church community,
yeah. Yes, ma'am.
We have just
duly noted.
Begun
yes,
at noon. After the church is closed, then there wouldn't be any problem.
I think that's easy.
Yeah.
Thank you. Start it down. Ms. Martin.
Alderman Bransford.
We hope the hotels will be full for those 2 days, so.
What hotel?
Getting.
All of them. We'll have more built by then, too.
Getting people from the hotel without cars may be something that I would like for you all to engage with the hoteliers to see if there's either some type of system.
Yes, ma'am.
You come out to the lobby and you get on XYZ and you get to the park. And
great.
That will leave a lot of cars parked at the hotels. So there could be some kind of circle pickup or something.
Yeah,
I don't know. So
perhaps something with the Franklin.
Yeah. Transit Authority.
Transit, and then we've great also
yeah,
spoken
because
about.
If you have friends and family coming to town, you know, half of them would be at your house and the other half would be at the hotel. So you don't want all those cars. So just try
yes,
to
maintain.
The trolleys worked well
yeah.
Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
We spoke, the trolleys work great. We've spoken to BGA about activating, I think they have 8 buses and some of the other schools. It, what's really fun is to see how people get kind of entrepreneurial and the kids, you know, they park cars in your yard, they
yeah.
serve, the churches serve, you know, stew or whatever, hot dogs,
yeah.
and everybody people gets in the game.
Mm-hmm. Good idea.
Other questions?
Alrighty.
One of the things I'd point out, we've got members from our CVB, local CVB staff here as well. They'll be working on this as part of the community team, of course, and listening in to some of the questions, comments, suggestions you made to work on this. This is truly a partnership that we all work on. So.
Don't we have a current jazz festival that goes on?
Not this year.
Is there conflict or
no,
is it in folding?
They're not doing it this year.
Okay, all right.
We think we've done our due diligence making sure there are no festivals around. But one thing about the pilgrimage that maybe I didn't articulate as well as I would like to have is that it's all types of music are going to be represented. On the stage, you may see Brad Paisley, then Blind Boys of Alabama, then you may see Maroon 5, all playing acoustic, too, which is unique. So it's going to be still be PA systems and stuff, but it's going to be acoustic, so it's not going to be loud, and that's what's going to make our festival unique and draw people to Franklin.
Alderman Blanton, and then Alderman McClendon.
I just wanted to say that I had the opportunity to sit in on a meeting in the early stages of this, which wasn't too long ago, and it's amazing just to see all the work and thought you guys have put in it and really listen to the people that you've talked to, and I'm impressed by where you are based on where we started and where we are now, and I think it's been a good job. So,
thanks, man.
Thank you.
Alderman McClendon.
I like the idea. So what I'm about to say is not intended to chill your enthusiasm. Have we looked carefully at all the restrictions that we imposed on Collinsdale when we bought it?
Land trust.
I assume by now that's been done. But I remember we talked about things like lights and amplification of sound, and it was a passive park and all that.
Absolutely, I think they've done a great job. One of the first things that we introduced to them is we did have a conservation easement on the property. They did need to meet with the land trust to have conversation. They have fulfilled that. It does meet our requirements. One of the things that has come from that, though, is not so much for their event, is to take a look at the signature, what we're considering would be a signature events on the park, and should we begin to look at how many we should have within a year's time, because we believe that they will probably provide probably set the bar, and you can see where others would say we feel like we could do something even different from this. So that was one of their comments that they come back is from that standpoint. But as far as what they have done, as far as the amplification, things are temporary. They're not building anything that's would stay on the property for future events at this point in time, or that has been introduced. So their land trust is in compliance. We have requested them put it in writing to the city so that we make sure that we have that.
Does that include alcohol sales on the premises?
Yes, we actually already had that from a city standpoint that we could serve alcohol on
only two parks within the city of Franklin allow for that type of usage is Harlansdale and Eastern Flank. So that was approved by the board at least about 3 or 4 years ago for that policy.
Okay.
Yep.
Everybody done?
Yep.
All right, thanks. We look forward to
appreciate y'all condition. Very much and are available, and staff knows how to get in touch with us. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to a biosolids facility visit, and Mr. Parker's coming up.
Guys can hang around for that. A lot of sewer talk.
Yeah. In case anyone wants to stick around, this is good stuff.
Make it fun.
Biosolids today.
Wanted to just take a little bit of time and walk through some learning. A group of us made a trip about 2 weeks ago to visit a number of installations that have thermal hydrolysis in place, which is a key component of our water reclamation facility, wastewater treatment plant upgrade and expansion that is being designed right now. And so I wanted to take a little time to walk through that with you tonight and answer any questions you might have. I've prepared some slides with some photos to give you a sense of that, and welcome Mayor Moore or David or Mark or Michelle to chime in on it. The purpose of our trip, I identified three primary purposes, is first to evaluate and see directly for ourselves the thermal hydrolysis process itself. Understand it and see how it works in action. And then also to understand how that fits into our design plan for our facility in terms of its upgrade and improvements. And then specifically to compare two vendors that are submitting proposals for the biosolid process by the end of this month that will be evaluated. And we need to make a pre-selection between those two vendors so that we can complete the design process. So that is something that will take the remainder of this year and probably come to the board in January for consideration and decision. So they'll turn it in, our engineering and design team will evaluate it and do some additional due diligence, then provide that to staff. Staff will do our review and due diligence and then make sure all those questions are answered and then bring a more complete picture to you with our evaluation analysis and recommendation. Okay, so thermal hydrolysis, just to hit the high points on that, is something that came out of our integrated water resource plan as the best option to provide long-term management of biosolids. It is a process and a technology that has its roots in the paper industry, but has been applied to wastewater and biosolid treatment, specifically in Europe, for over 15 years in locations, and more installations are looking at it now. In fact, on our heels, the following week, folks from Palo Alto, California, were making a similar visit to sites that we were located, that where we went and visited. Also, Hampton Roads, Virginia, Pensacola, Florida, Raleigh, North Carolina, San Antonio, Charlotte, just to name some, a couple other cities in Pennsylvania. So there's a list of communities in the United States that are looking very seriously at this technology and incorporating into their plant upgrades and designs. Specifically, Washington, D.C. has a large plant, the largest plant in the world, with thermal hydrolysis that has just started its commissioning process in the last week or so. So this is a technology that is being looked to with promise, and the reasons are it is a very efficient process. It introduces high temperature and high pressure into the biosolid treatment process. That high temperature kills all the pathogens. It also basically ruptures the cell walls, which releases water and reduces the volume of biosolids that come through the process. And you'll see some vivid demonstrations of how much that reduces the volume of
That's
what
okay.
we have at the end of the process. Not too vivid, but you'll see that in this coming up. And again,
bring the samples?
It produces, we do have some samples, yes. We do have Class A solids that are produced at the end of this process.
My city administrator went to Europe and all I got was this jar of samples.
We'll have them available for review after the meeting.
During dinner.
Yeah, exactly. A key component, and we spent a lot of time in the integrated water resource process talking about Class A solids and how important that was, how that eliminated the 100-mile one-way dumping of waste-activated sludge at a landfill, and that's, all that's true. And this allows us to go to an agricultural application, which can be much more efficient, and has the potential for us to actually recapture some revenue long-term. The other piece we did not speak so much about that became very clear to us is how much this reduces the size of other components of the treatment process. Because you've reduced that volume of biosolids, for example, our digester can be 50 to 60% smaller because there's less biosolids coming through that process that needs to go in the digester. And so that is not only true for this expansion, that will be true for the next expansion and the expansion or construction after that. As we've designed this and as this is coming forward, this thermal hydrolysis process and proposal is not just for this plant, it's for the 30-year horizon for what we will need in the community for biosolid processing. Let me go on. Mark, did you want to chime in?
Well, the digester sizes, Eric mentioned the digesters. We're looking at the design capacity is 1.5 million gallons at this point. So I think originally we were about 3.5 to 4 million gallons digester size previously. So huge cost savings in terms of construction and materials and controls of the digester. So
Here are the two vendors that we saw and the elements that we looked at. Cambi is they're the vendor that is providing the system in Washington, D.C. They are based in Norway. The facilities that we looked at for them was Davyhulme, which is a large facility located in Manchester, England. We also saw a Manchester fabrication or assembly site where they're putting together a unit and actually saw a unit that would be very similar to what they're proposing for us. And then we traveled to Næstved, Denmark, which is about 90 kilometers south of Copenhagen, to a 15-year-old plant or 14 to 15-year-old plant, similar to Franklin's size, actually a little smaller than us. For Kruger, which is the U.S. name, but his parent company is Veolia, which is a large French company that does energy, water and wastewater, and waste management. We visited them at their corporate headquarters and met their senior team. We also visited the plant in northern France in Lille, and then in southern France in Pia, which is near Perpignan. So that's in southern France. So we'll walk through some images. First, looking at Cambi, this is the diagram of their thermal hydrolysis process. Just looking at those units, you've got on each end, and you've got on the left-hand side, you've got the pulper tank, which accepts the biosolids, introduces the initial steam and heating of those, and then goes into one of the four reactors. And really the Cambi system, while they call it a continuous process, it is really batches going through each reactor. And so they go into the reactor, the steam and high temperature is introduced, it essentially cooks in the reactor for 20 to 30 minutes, which gets it to the pathogen kill and the destruction of the cell walls, and then moves it into the flash tank, which begins the depressurization and the cooling process on the right-hand side. So it really works in batches. It fills a tank, cooks it, for lack of a better term, and then moves it on into the flash tank. Okay, so let's see it in action. This is Davyhulme, Manchester, England. This is a long-term wastewater treatment plant. It is actually the first plant in the world to produce the waste-activated sludge. So it's been there for, I don't know, 100 years, something like that. It's been there a long, long time. And it's a large plant, long-time operating plant, but has introduced the thermal hydrolysis in about the last 2 years. It's just under 2 years old. It's a large plant, as I said, 91,000 tons of dry solid produced per year is the capacity. It does also bring in significant amounts of biosolids from other treatment facilities in their region. Essentially, the way the United Kingdom is set up, they've got 10 very large utilities that operate regionally. And this serves a large section of that. That's what you see the truck delivering the sludge or biosolid to the plant for treatment. You see the slide on the right is storage areas. The silo in the middle is the sludge that's produced on site, the biosolid on site, and the others on the other either side are the ones that are trucked in from other facilities. So they store them there and then move them into the thermal hydrolysis process.
What was the odor factor? Any there?
As far as, as far as right here, if you're standing there, you've got a smell. But once you get into the thermal hydrolysis, there is no smell.
It's a pressurized, closed vessels.
It's completely enclosed. So the only place we got any smell was one of the reactors was offline. They were doing some cleaning or work on it, and one of the pipes was open, and we could get a little smell from that. But everywhere else where it's functioning, it's completely enclosed.
At what point does the water, is the water removed from the process?
The
water that we haul
from the biosolid?
Where will it go? At what point does it?
The water that's removed through the biosolids process goes back to the head of the plant. Mm-hmm. So it's an effluent out of the biosolids that's reintroduced back into the plant to go through the process.
And there's dewatering both early in the process and at the end of the process, right. Correct?
Right.
Correct, yes. So the final dewatering would occur after the THP process.
Okay.
So that's further down the treatment train.
And THP itself is a pretreatment before it goes into the digestive
right.
process. So it's important to remember that. And you'll see that as we go through here.
How much is the 91,000 metric tons?
It's a lot.
Compared to
it is. It's significantly larger than ours. It's probably 30 times larger.
20 to 25 times larger than us.
Than our size. It is a large. This is a large facility. And you'll see, this gives you some context of how large these treatment facilities are. What's proposed for us are much smaller, and you'll see that a little later. On the right, you see the reactors, and you see David in the foreground there. So that gives you some context.
Wow.
They're pretty tall. They're, I would say that's about a two-story high installation there. The first unit you see on the left is the pulper tank, which again is where the it's sort of a storage, but its initial gets a consistency of about 18% solids with the introduction of steam and the initial in elevation of temperature moves it into the reactors, and those are the units you see there. I'll move to this next. This is a more up close piece of the showing the reactors. You see these three here at the bottom. Those are injecting steam and at high temperature, around 150 degrees Celsius, into the biosolid. So it's basically blasting it, elevating it, and then it cooks in those reactors for about 20 minutes.
Were there any efficiency in the kilowatts used? Did they talk about that at all?
Well, there is gas that is produced in the process that can be reused in the facility itself. This facility, because of the sludge that comes in from other facilities, is almost entirely energy self-sufficient, around 95%.
Almost energy neutral.
Almost energy neutral is the better term. And they are optimistic they will reach 100% or full because of that. Now, our expectation would be a little different with our own, they have multiple other plants bringing, and you saw that holding area where there's really one-third is what they produced and two-thirds is coming from the outside world in terms of the treatment plants. So our estimate would be somewhere in that 30-35%. I think we're still hashing that out, but that's a rough estimate that we would be able to produce energy to offset what we need. Plus remember, we have the solar fields out there, and we're looking at an opportunity to enhance those as well. So those could also play into a greater offset of energy needs in the facility.
We're looking at several different things. Of course, the CHP unit that would accompany the biosolids process the solar fields operations, we continue to refine.
What's CHP?
Combined heat and power, generating electricity or energy back to the, to our facility.
This would be from the methane gas coming off the digesters.
Correct.
Which, you know, I don't want to interject too much.
Spoil the show here.
You'll see that, but go ahead.
There's going to be a few questions, and now we've already started doing that.
Do you want us to write these questions down, or do we ask them as you're visiting those facilities, if we have specific questions of those facilities?
How about we move through the facility and then stop for a moment?
And then talk about that facility?
If there's something I'm saying or we're saying that you're not understanding, let us clarify, but when we get to the end of it, we'll stop and see if there's any questions about that.
For each facility?
How about that?
Yeah, that sounds good. I just want to make sure what we're doing here.
So after we've done the thermal hydrolysis itself, you've got what's called hydrolyzed sludge. All right, and it moves into a heat exchange, a cooling process. This is a little hard to see. You see these units that almost look like heating cooling units on top? Below them is a network of piping that cools the sludge to a temperature that it needs to be to then move it into the digesters and the digestive process. So our facility would actually not have these units on top. There is an opportunity to capture that heat and use that also as part of the process and return some of that steam back into the process in the pulper tank that started the process. So that was also something we saw. And then the picture on the right as you look at it, that is the piping of these to these large digesters. Again, this is a big plant. Large digesters in the process. So these go to there, and there's a equalization between temperatures and what's needed in that digester element of the treatment process. Anything else on this?
I think they were also using recycled heat to also help heat that plant.
Yes, they were. Here
did that
is,
have an odor?
What's that?
Did that have an odor?
No, they're not. This is the gas collection. This comes from the digesters and is stored and then used to, let me move to the next picture. These are engines and a boiler unit that are run off of that gas. They have three of these operating right now. They are adding two more to help use the gas that's produced as an energy source. And then this is the final dewatering and final product. You see Michelle taking a sniff.
Can't smell
right there on the right.
It didn't smell. It didn't.
It was around a 28% to 30% solid. I would compare it to almost like a little bit of a damp potting soil. Right. Is that a fair comparison to give you a sense? So if when I hear 30%, I would think it would be more liquid. It's fairly dry. And then at that point they use it for agricultural application, and they have some other uses as well. Did they use it? Was this the one that used it? Wasn't there an asphalt plant or a, maybe that was the?
There was a cement plant that burned the final biosolid for energy. They were burning it.
I think that was the Lil
that was, France that was Lil
installation. I'm sorry. I'm getting
could you use this for potting soil?
Yes.
You could. It's a class A solid. It is what we're going to need to look at is what the market wants. Mm-hmm. What level of dryness? What does a farmer want to put on their field? How dry does it need to be? And one of the bid alternates in the design is whether to have a solar dryer at the end of this process. And so that's one of the things that'll be bid in this, and that we saw an installation we'll show at the end that has a solar drying arrangement.
We talked about that, didn't we?
Yes. Okay, that's that completes the Manchester installation that we saw there. So let me stop for a second and see what else.
All right.
No, go ahead, Alderman.
All right.
I'm sorry.
So did they say, since they were in operation for so many years, long time, did they say what challenges they had in switching over to the system or any Did they talk to you about their bringing all this online?
Right. We spent a lot of time talking with the operators. They were the ones who actually brought us through the plant. And some of the concerns we've had are training. What specialized training do we need? You know, how long does it take to learn how this works? Because you look at this, the process, particularly at this plant, this is a B6 facility. We're getting a B2, so it's considerably smaller. But you look at it, and it's somewhat overwhelming. The training that they did with their operators, they all have the same operators that they had previously. I think the operators picked it up very quickly and learned it to how to operate it. Some of the issues that they noted were not directly related with the THP. It was more associated with removing moisture out of the biogas. So that was one of the points that they wanted to ensure we made sure when we did design for removing moisture out of the gas that we took a close look at that.
So it burns cleaner.
Yeah.
Right. Some of the other issues were the percent solids material that they were importing. They would produce a solid that had X percent solids, and then you would import all these different varieties of solids. So that was a bit of an issue when they first started up bringing solids in from other plants. What they did to alleviate that was ensure that if they're going to import to the site, that they needed to maintain a specific percent solids and that they brought in. And after they had done that, things, I think, moved really smoothly through it. Those are the only issues that I can think of specifically with THP. There were some other elements that were kind of within the biosolids, but not THP related. I don't know.
I just reemphasize what Mark said. One of the things we were really asked about was, you know, this finding the right staff to run the operation.
Yeah,
was that difficult?
That.
And it was really, to them, a non-issue. They took existing staff and picked it up very quickly. In the Nested installation in Denmark, they actually said the guy we have doing it needed a job. He needed something to, you know, he sort of bounced around, needed a job. We said, well, let's have him do it. And he picked it up and has done it for 12 years since then. So
who does the training for these people? The company
the
we
companies
hire?
Companies do the training. Naval. Yes. The companies,
that's
and that's one thing I want to say, each one of these processes are, we'll only have one train. These plants, some of these plants have two and three, four trains. They commission each train separately.
Okay.
Commission is they start operating, they have to fill up things and get it going. So they commission each one separate, and as they're doing that, the company itself, and they will have the operators along with them. In fact, you try to have the operators along with the construction of it also, where they see what's going on. So, and that's what's good about being able to use your existing operators. They're there anyway. They'll be watching the construction. They'll be going along with the commissioning agent for the company that is starting up the equipment and teaching them.
Right.
And then you have that particular company on board with you for an extended period of time after you start operations to work out any bugs, et cetera, but also for further training.
Oh,
so
I would think our contract, number one, would have the training in there.
One
but
year's
they
worth.
Would also have to hang around for so...
We are set up for
very
1 year's worth of training after its operation.
Yeah, I would be very interested to find out what the contract would require because, of course, they do this, so they know what to do, but I'd like to know how long they would be available to us. So
well, we're requiring a minimum of a year.
Of a year? Okay.
From when it's
online. Yeah, I
online.
Think so, because right. it's so... All right, the other thing, real quick. What about our solar fields over there? Is it going to be an interference? Or are we going to have
we're
enough?
Working around that.
Well, okay, that's not going to... We don't have to have them take any of that away?
We've met with them on several occasions, and
right.
we're in good shape.
Okay, and what's the material those tanks are made out of? What do they make this?
Stainless steel.
Is it stainless?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yes.
Okay, and then you talked about the heat coming off of those units. They were taking that to heat some of the plants. We had talked about that at one time. Are we planning on doing that or looking into it?
We're going to recover all the heat we can. Initially, we're going to try to use the heat to preheat the liquids, preheat the sludge, et cetera.
Uh-huh.
So that's part of what we're setting up in our design. We're going to try to capture all of the residuals that we can capture and reuse it.
Okay, and the last question I have is what level the market wants us, because, you know, all along I said this grade A biosolids are, you know, there's some demand out there and we need to look at selling that. So are we familiar with, are we going to be looking into what the, like, I think, Eric, you brought that up, what the market really wants, how dry, how wet.
We have actually had meetings with the hauler that takes care of Metro's biosolids in Memphis and
Louisville,
et cetera. He does a lot of it in the southeast. In fact, we met with him again yesterday. We're looking at what we're going to need to do to get this market. They'll do most of the marketing, but as it, there's something that we'll be continually looking at and getting squared away as we go forward. We have not got that completely settled, but his indication is he will take what we can give him off of a solar dryer. At actually, he said he'd take it 60% dry solids or better. So, but we don't want to go too dry because then it gets too dusty. So then he has
right.
Some problem
then you're going to have
so.
Issue with that because it has to have some water left in it.
Right, and there's different grades that you, I mean, you can go to pelletizing and all this other stuff, which. So those are some of the things that we're
whatever we do here, I just want to make sure that we have done that homework before, so when we put the system in place, we've got the right degree of drying so we can sell it or use it.
The way I understand it is you're going to start around a 28 or 30% solids at the beginning of the process. Then you introduce it to whatever drying technique we use. We're talking about solar drying.
Okay.
It will progress. The longer it's there, the higher that number gets. So if 60% is your target, you're going to manage that process of turning and rotating
to
out
get it
that,
where you want it.
That biosolids to that level. And
okay.
Then you move it through these, essentially folks who broker this out to agriculture to land apply it and use it as part of their business.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Sure. I had a couple of notes I might just interject real quick. First of all, this plant's been in operation for 2 years.
The THP element is.
Right. THP, yes. And then my notes said that half of it did go to incineration. Then the other comment that they made was that one of the reasons they went to THP was because of the higher gas production. Because of the higher degree of digestion, or the higher degree...
It's coming off here.
That's not the correct term I'm using. Because of the thermal hydrolysis, when it goes into the digester, it creates a lot more gas.
Great.
Yep.
All right, so the Cambi unit itself comes in a Franklin scale. All right, we saw this big plant, but we were able to go to where they're fabricating, assembling this unit. It's called a B2, you may have heard Mark say. It's a much smaller unit.
Yep.
It's roughly the size of that wall over there. It's maybe 14 feet wide, 14 feet high, and about 28 feet long. It's about the size of a shipping container. And so it's not real large, and it's as you see on the right-hand side, it just, you essentially kind of plug it in. It's almost a modular unit. You plug in your feed and plug it in for the electrical power needs, and it functions. And it's basically, and you see people standing by it, so you see that scale is much more human. And it's mounted on a skid and essentially would come to you that way. And this just shows you that. That was the picture with David in front of the large unit at Manchester at Davy Hume. And then there's Mark standing next to the B2 unit, which is what's going to be proposed for Franklin by Cambi. And so it's just same composition. It's got the pulper tank, it's got four reactors, and it's got the flash tank at the end. It's just in the scale that will manage our capacity. But again, our capacity for the 30-year planning horizon. Not just this plant expansion, but all the way out through the 30 years, that's the capacity that this will be able to handle. Okay, so that really just shows you, we got to see what would be proposed for us.
Does the time, like the other ones, you said, like, staying there 20 or 30 minutes? Because it's smaller, is it obviously a lesser time in that?
No, it's same time.
It is?
It's a requirement for time based by the EPA. It's okay. An EPA requirement.
Yeah, there's basically a definition. Get it at a certain temperature for a certain amount of time. By definition, gets it to a Class A solid. The pathogens are killed. The other benefit of the pressure is to what's it called? Lysis, which blasts those cell walls and releases the water. Well, I didn't want to say this. Other words. Yeah,
did you say the one they're using that's been there for 2 years is about three times the size of the one they would be giving us?
Yes, it's much larger.
All right. And where did they get all their?
Well, they're a much larger plant, and they have multiple other plants bring biosolids to them.
Oh, okay.
So it's more of a regional facility, and the biosolids handling component is regionalized too. So people do treatment to a certain level, produce a waste-activated sludge like we do, and they bring it there for the rest of the process.
Do you think anybody would want to do that to us?
That is a potential option for us to accept.
Would we want that?
Why not?
Well, you've got issues with knowing the consistency of what you get, just like Mark talked about. That's one of the issues. They've had to get it to a certain level of solid, that 28 to 30% to start with, I think, is the initial point. It's an option for us, and it is something that could help us produce more gas, save more on energy costs, and you know, if we're able to generate revenue at the end of the process, could help us there as well. It's got other components.
But we'll be limiting ourselves by getting this small.
To a certain degree, if we decide to import solids, we're going to have to consider our growth in terms of solids in the long run.
Yeah.
What will the other facilities do when we start growing into the size of the facility we build? We overbuild too much now. There's a capital expenditure associated with that. And you know, if we're going to do that, do we want to follow our growth and their growth in terms of solids?
Yeah, for the first 10-15 years, you're not going to have capacity issue.
Right.
As you get further in the planning horizon, and we're a bigger city and we're handling more.
So what do we do then?
Volume, then we would have to stop accepting others.
Can we grow?
As more of the volume is our own. Obviously, our volume is always going to take priority. But it is an option for us to look at.
Or add on.
You mentioned the cost. Has anybody said approximately the cost of this?
The full biosolids component is around $50 to $55 million. The thermal hydrolysis unit itself, roughly around 20% of that cost is what we're expecting, that unit. The whole process incorporates other elements, et cetera. So that gives you a...
That 50 to 55% then would be
50 to 55 million.
$55 million for what process?
It's the entire biosolids.
The full biosolids.
Entire biosolids.
Right, so we're about $10 million roughly for THP and I guess the other components that tie into the interfaces with the other processes.
But big picture, it's around a $50 million component, to which this is a critical piece.
Well, isn't that significantly less than what we have talked about?
That's out of our...
It's right. The whole plant is around $100 million. So this is about half, a little over half of that is the biosolids component.
Okay.
And again, it's a biosolid solution for the full 30-year horizon. It's not just this plant expansion and upgrade, it's all the way through the 30-year planning horizon.
Well, what happens in 10 years if we want to go into accepting and build and growing? Do we have to put on an additional, how do we grow this system?
Well, we're designing to take care of the city of Franklin. That's what our design is for.
Sure.
Is being done. Yeah. So if you get to the point where you want to start accepting something else, you're going to have to look at some additional infrastructure to be able to handle that. Paralleling, having another another parallel train or something like that. You will not be able to ultimately excel outside of the city of Franklin and then serve the city of Franklin. What is being designed right now? You'd have to design something else. You'd have to design and construct a receiving station like you saw where the dump trucks were dumping or whatever. You'd have to do that too. So there's other elements that are not a part of this.
But my question is, you wouldn't have to scrap it all and start from scratch.
No.
You can add on and it's like a house. You've got a house that can add an addition on to make it bigger.
Yeah. Right. So you would have to consider the
receiving stations, you can add those on.
Right. So additional digester capacity.
Yeah.
If we're gonna dry material, then we need to consider additional drying.
Have any of these plants that you all visited done that? Were they added on?
With the Davy Hume one, I think since they're more of a UK does that regional type treatment, I think that was part of the original design when they went to the THP system.
Okay. I might move some. I want to stay focused on the processes and the companies.
Now we're going to go to the second Cambi installation we looked at, which is Næstved, Denmark. This is the operation that it serves about a population of around 50,000 people. It's 14 years old. You can see, it may be hard to see, this scale is much smaller and is a plant, again, that's operating just under 1,800 tons of dry solids per year. So it's much smaller. We would be a little bit larger than this at the outset, and then as we reached our 30-year horizon, a good bit larger than this facility. Same concept, just in a smaller scale. Here is the one difference I would highlight for you. I talked about the cooling heat exchange component. You'll see on the left-hand side, it's just a series of pipes. This is what they have, wall-mounted, fairly manageable scale. You see the mayor standing right there. So gives you a sense it's not a real large unit. Runs along the wall, allows it to cool as it runs through those and moves into the digester process after it's gone through thermal hydrolysis. They used belt presses to dewater both before the process and after the process. So on the right-hand side, you see that sort of opened up. They had a hood that covered it for, I think, noise control. But they opened that up for us to look at. Again, not a lot of, even with that belt press, we got sort of an ammonia smell, but not a lot of smell in that. And that's a pre-treatment component. Again, no smell from the actual THP process itself. This is interesting to look at. This is approximately 11 months of their biosolid production. That's a kind of pavilion storage area. I don't know, roughly the size of a football field is what I would say. Does that sound right?
I was thinking smaller.
A little bit smaller.
Yeah. It was not real large. And you see that's they do not have a system to turn it and help it dry further. They just were storing it there. And then they also use it for some agricultural application, and they also have an incinerator on site. They have a solid waste operation that does some incineration. So I think they're about 50-50 as well from this site in terms of agricultural application and some nearby incineration. Again, you see the solids and being held in somebody's hand, same consistency that we saw at the Manchester site, around 30% solids at that point. It was the same process, just in a smaller scale and one that's been operating for 14 years. They collected gas as well. I don't remember what their return was on that or what they did. You guys remember that?
They recycled heat. I don't think they generated energy though.
Okay, they didn't do the gas quite the same way. Okay. They did have a gas collection system as well though, off of the system, I thought.
Okay. That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
For part of their incineration. So I don't have a percentage return on that. They're not set up quite for that.
There's a large
they burn their garbage.
Right, they burn the garbage next door, and I think it goes towards that facility.
To help shave off energy costs from that operation. Incineration of solid waste is much more common in these countries compared to what we have in the United States. Anything else I can answer for you on this?
Are we going to get to see the others?
What's that?
Are we going to get to see the others?
Yeah. We'll move on to, so that really gives you the CAMI solution, which is this batching solution, goes through into a reactor, one at a time, you know, fills a reactor, cooks it, moves it into the process. Now we're going to look at what Kruger, which they have a more continuous process. The brand name for it is Exelis. And this is a plant in northern France, in Lille, France, operates around 24,000 tons of dry solids. It is an upgraded plant. It's been there a long time as well, but it's an upgraded plant that's now incorporating thermal hydrolysis and is in the midst of commissioning. What they have, four treatment trains?
Right, two in commission.
Two were commissioned and two more were coming on that we saw. Kruger has another process that is more batch process, more similar to the CAMBI, that they are moving away from. They feel it's attractive to have this more continuous excellence process, so that's what they're proposing for us and wanted to show us, which again is a continuous flow. You don't need to batch it, and we'll show you how that works. Again, it's got a lot of the same processes in terms of dewatering and processing the biosolids before it enters in. And this is harder to see. On the left-hand side, you've got a bin that stores the biosolids and then enters into the process. You'll see here is where steam is injected into the process here at a temperature and at a pressure, and then enters their reactor, which is essentially a long encased tube with three runs, back and forth and back and forth.
This one does not have, has the vertical component you just saw a picture, which goes up to the next level, which is a horizontal component. It's a long component, that's the reactor. What they're proposing for us is only a vertical, it would only be vertical, it's
1 meter by six.
Yes, about 5-6 meters tall. It's basically two pipes inside another pipe. So it goes, the process, the sludge enters, goes up, comes back down, and then goes back up. So it's a little bit different than what this is.
It's the same concept. It's one's horizontal, one's vertical.
Right.
Same idea. It goes on a pipe run, and that provides the cooking time.
Right.
Essentially. And it can continually flow through those pipes, and the pace that it moves through provides for that cooking time, and they can document that it fits that so that it can meet the EPA definition. I just showed the little gauges that are on there, and there are a number. You see these little blue probes. They're different places throughout the reactor. Those are temperature sensors. And you've got that, you see that, if you read that, it says 156, that's the temperature that it's cooking at, essentially, right there. So you've got these different gauges that allow you to monitor it, and the sensors that are through there.
Where are they documenting the data for EPA or state or whatever?
Their version of EPA.
Whatever, I mean, I would think they would have a documentation for those readings and things. Is the technicians doing that? Manually?
It's all computerized. So we'll get, I think you probably have a picture of their SCADA system in there.
I probably do.
Okay.
But it makes sense for it to be computerized.
I do have those pictures, they're just not in this slide.
So we're upgrading, so their SCADA system, which is the supervisory control system, it allows you to operate the system remotely from the admin
just
building.
Push a button.
It historically tracks all this data and temperature, and so as part of the plant upgrades, which will be the biosolids, we're upgrading our SCADA system too.
So there is redundancy built into both systems in terms of the multiple reactors in the CAMI system. And in this, one of the things we talked to them about is having multiple components or redundancy in the component that injects the steam and the pressure. So that if some reason, since we have one reactor here, some reason that's the critical component. If some reason that goes offline, you have a second one in place. So that's one of the things we've requested of them, and we'll see in their proposal at the end of the month. So It's, again, similar concept, but there is not a storage component in terms of sitting in a reactor. It just continues to flow through in their process. And this is just other views of the reactor. Again, it goes horizontal as opposed to vertical, and what they're proposing for us would actually be a vertical unit. The picture on the left is where the steam is injected. It's a different view of that. And then it goes into cooling as well. The difference in the Kruger system is that it maintains at pressure. The cooling process in the Cambi system, when it went to that flash tank, the pressure began to reduce and the temperature cooling started, and then further cooling happened in the heat exchanger. This remains in pressure through the cooling or heat exchange process. Just a different philosophy. And then there's some gas collection. You can see that on the right side, and dewatering. I believe they used a centrifuge here as well.
And those gases they were collecting there were not the gases they're burning. They were kind of
the waste gas.
That's waste gas from the process. And then they also have larger, just like you saw at the Manchester site, kind of a large collection system that comes off of the digester, because that's where you really produce the volume of gas, is in that digestive process. They used a heating or thermal drying system at this unit. You see the large orange, it's almost like an oven. The picture on the right is, The picture on the right is the inside of that, where the solids come out of that nozzle, and it's a slow moving conveyor that then further cooks it and dries it.
What comes out of the nozzle?
The biosolids.
Oh.
The treated biosolid. Comes out of the nozzle and then it just sort of rolls through.
Like a big Quiznos oven.
It is. It's like the subs and Quiznos. that's the method they used. It is much more energy intensive in terms of using the heat and the gas to heat those units, but that is the method they chose at this site. A couple other things. This is really not so much related to ours, but just interesting. Our solution, but interesting. They included on their clarifiers, they have these sort of wood lattice structures along the side. They plan to grow like ivy up the side of their clarifiers, and they're going to have a green roof. So this will be a green facility that has materials growing up the side. And in fact, actually, at the beginning, I should have showed you, they had a green wall. You've heard of a green roof? Their operations building has a vegetated wall. It was very attractive, too, very interesting. So they plan to do that on this clarifier as well. Okay, so let me stop there. Kruger, that was their solution. It seems to be a little bit of a simpler process, but the same concept, just applied on a continuous flow. There's fewer stops in the process in terms of thermal hydrolysis.
It looked more antiquated, like Bubba just kind of welded it together. It didn't look as, yeah, I mean, it looked more homemade, especially at the end with that orange thing.
And that's the process we actually would not have. That's the choice they made in terms of how they wanted to dry their solids. We're looking at a solar drying, which is like a green approach.
So one of the benefits of that is that it's the operator complexity is greatly reduced
because of the
pumps in the pipes. Our guys have experience taking care of those.
There does seem to be at least one or two steps fewer in this process, and less in this process in terms of working through. But again, something we'll still have to assess when all these proposals come in and how they fit with our system.
We get through this.
Anything else on Kruger?
No. I think you've done a good job on
okay.
that.
The final piece that we saw was this location in PS, southern France. And it was really more of a standard wastewater plant, but the important component to see that was unique in this structure was their solar drying system. And so you'll see this. unit. Again, it looks like a large greenhouse. Mm-hmm. It's maybe, what was the length of that? Do you guys remember?
70 meters.
So about 220 feet in length. Our unit might be a little larger than that. And it disperses their solids into it. They have this unit that operates and turns it and puts it in windrows. And sort of continuously, slowly goes around to turn the solids and help them dry out further. They reach an over 90% dry component. And you'll kind of see here, there's a track that it runs along in the middle. And so it's just tied to that track and it just goes around. And to complete a route, it took about 45 minutes to go all the way around.
Is it heated?
It's solar heated. Because of the nature, it then uses the sunlight to create the heat. It's like a greenhouse.
But this was after the thermal hydraulics?
This is after the treatment process. So
this did not have thermal hydraulics.
This did, but you would use the same unit here. Yeah.
It did not have thermal hydraulics.
This was a conventional plant, did not have thermal.
This Solia, or Solia is the name of the unit, but the solar unit is a newer application. And this is one they wanted to show us in terms of how it operates, because this is what is likely to be proposed for Franklin. It has this unit. It has the building on the end. You see in the lower slide, or the slide in the foreground, that's an odor control facility at the end, which essentially draws air from the greenhouse through it and up through a filter that's on the roof. It's almost like the stones you'd see in an aquarium. And it draws it through there. We didn't get a whole lot of odor. Even in the unit itself, when you went to the corner, you got sort of an ammonia smell. But it was not real strong. They had the doors open when we got there, and we didn't smell anything until we got in. We got inside. So it manages to dissipate odor pretty well. But that's the unit that has an odor management component.
So how much, what would be the projected cost of this then?
This is all part of your biosolid solution.
No, but I'm asking, you said it doesn't have the thermal hydrolysis, so.
We primarily went there to look at the drying.
To see the drying
component. This process, without having to dry it and do all kinds of checks on the sludge,
Right.
Out of the greenhouse is not a Class A. It's not a guaranteed Class A. It could be a Class A, but it's not guaranteed. Mm-hmm. Whereas going through the thermal hydrolysis process, you're getting that.
Isn't that what we had out here when we sprayed it on the fields?
No,
not really.
I mean, without the greenhouse.
It was a lot more liquid. This gets it to a drier state, which can be used for agriculture.
But not A. It won't come out A.
Well,
this
is the drying component. You've reached Class A at the end of the thermal hydrolysis process. This provides you a method for drying that end product.
Right, and going back to one of Eric's initial comments was that through THP you get that reduction in material, significant reduction, so that translates again into the smaller digesters and smaller drying facilities as well, which would be part of that. But this not being a THP material, it's not a significant difference between drying a THP material and the material they had here.
That's the slides I have. We'll get this out to you. I just completed it over the weekend, so I apologize for that. And we'll also post it on the website in terms of the agenda item like we normally do. So this just gives you a sense of what we saw. Again, this process, proposals are due in at the end of the month. Our design team will evaluate that and ask some questions, get some more clarification, provide it to staff by the end of November and into early December. There'll be some additional evaluation. I'd expect we'll have an analysis and recommendation to you in January.
This is a wonderful, wonderful report. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was important for us to get the chance to see it in person directly and very, very helpful in our understanding of how this works and fits into what we're designing for, you know, a 30-year planning horizon.
I think the discussions with the operators was hugely important for us.
Most helpful, yeah. So that was
good. What's the toughest part of the maintenance?
Pumps.
Pumps.
Mainly pumps.
Things that we
deal with,
yeah, already. There's an annual inspection that needs to occur, but that's all planned in the maintenance schedule.
The 14-year-old facility had very little maintenance issues, right, at all, especially on the thermal hydrolysis component. They were, it's kind of a plug it in and go process.
Had very few employees.
Yeah, that's right.
What are they promising on the usable life on the chambers or the big piping? What are the
There will be guaranteed warranties, et cetera, but we don't actually have that at this point. That would be a part of the proposal process. But it is stainless steel, and they, as Eric said, they have not seen the wear and tear creating problems. That one has been in service for 14 years.
14 years, so that's really the oldest. It's basically the oldest
we saw, yeah.
The oldest one
it's
we
the
saw.
Second oldest, I think, installation.
Yeah. Right.
And that's a good halfway point, but with a 30-year projection.
So we're ready to move on, because this is just sticking our toe in the water. Next is consideration contract 2014-0226, cooperation agreement for Reddick Street Apartments payment in lieu of tax agreement. Anybody got any questions
just a
about
continuation
that?
Of what
continuing
we
that with more developments and additional units.
Okay, number four is consideration of contract for the receipt of community-based development organization funding to Hard Bargain Association.
Same thing there.
We've talked about this in the
yeah,
past. This provides some infrastructure for that development in Hard Bargain.
And then number five is consideration resolution 2014-78 to be entitled a resolution to submit an application for the Nashville Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, Tennessee Department of Transportation for the Multimodal Access Grant Program, which is basically asking for funding grant for the sidewalks on Murfreesboro Road. Then number six.
I do want to point out that, though, it is on your voting session also, because
we have
this submitted by Friday.
There's an October 31st
decision. So it is on your voting session also.
Good.
And then six is consideration of waiver of conflict for representation of public building authority.
With the DEPFA transaction, the building authority is involved, and Doug Berry has served as your attorney on certain issues and is also the attorney of the public building authority. So we need you to say it's okay for him to work with them in sharing this information.
Why not?
Okay. I can explain DEFA if you want me to.
No, thank you.
We'll see you in
5 minutes.
Let's go.